love. What is love? Anybody else? You just started singing it. Yeah. Oh, man. It's called musical Tourette's is what I call it. And if you have it, you're a walking jukebox. We just walk around. Somebody says a line. It's a blessing and a curse. You just start singing right there. You don't even need a microphone. I'm grateful for those people. What is love? I believe that there is a misconception on what love is today. Because the world has defined what love is by the celebrity couples that we watch on television, by the TV shows that we consume, the music that we listen to, because the things that we consume is often what we embody, that when you consume it, it will consume you. So if the things we consume is a worldly love, then the love that we live out will be one of the same. But we know that love is not something that just makes you feel good. It's not just something that affirms your feelings, but love is actually something that brings you back into your divine design because God is, it says it in 1 John 4:16, we know how much God loves us and we put our trust in his love. God is, and all who live in God, and God lives in them. That God is love. He is love. He is the embodiment of love. And if we are going to live a life that looks like Christ, well, then it cannot be one that is void of love. That if we want to reflect who Christ is through us, which is what we're called to, we were created in the Imago Dei, which is the image of God. We were created to be image bearers of the Lord. And in order to do that, we must walk in love. And what is love? Well, it is God. I've learned that the more time that you spend around somebody, the better that you can understand how to love them well. Well, in order to understand what the love of God is, it lists many attributes in 1 Corinthians 13 and 4 through 7. It says this, we read it last week. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it's not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, and it always perseveres. We know that if we were to replace the word love with the word God in this scripture, that it would read the same, that God is patient, that God is kind. He does not boast. He is not self-seeking. He is not easily angered. He protects us. He trusts us. He hopes. My question's not, does God carry these attributes? My question is, if you put your name in this verse, would it read the same? And how would you read it? I know this. I'm better at some of them than I am at others. Patience is a virtue, and it's a virtue I'm still trying to gain. It's like an acquired taste. It's something that you grow into. I'm hoping it's that way. There's things that we're better at than others, but none of this matters if we don't walk in love, because love is the central character to all of these attributes. So that is the first step that we must carry. I've learned again that you more time you spend around somebody, the better you learn to love them, and the more time that you spend with the Lord, the better you love other people. I have learned some of the things that I thought my wife loved when we were dating are not necessarily things that she loves now. We met just about 11 years ago, and it was a six-month hiatus of being in relationships because I had gotten heartbroken, and I'm not going to give you my episode of The Bachelor, but I just was frustrated and angry, and I invested too much. And so I told the Lord, I said, God, I'm not talking to another girl. I don't want a relationship. I want to work on me and you. I want to tell you this. The first step to fixing you is fixing your relationship with the Lord. First step to fixing any relationship, fix your relationship with the Lord. First step to fixing your workplace environment, fix your relationship with the Lord. This is step one. 6 months later of me and the Lord doing a lot of time together and just serving him and trying to be wherever he was. I wanted to be at church every day. I wanted to serve. I wanted to be in a group. I didn't care what it was. I wanted to do the things of the Lord. 6 months later, I walk into this college service. I'm there to help lead worship that week, and I see this beautiful angel serving people donuts. Come on. That's the ultimate double whammy. Beautiful woman and donuts. And they love the Lord, that's a good trinity right there. I saw this beautiful woman serving people donuts, and she was on the guest team, and I looked at my buddies, and I said, I don't know who that girl is, but I'm going to marry her. One of them said, dude, you're a little weird. I was like, yeah, that's true. The other guy said, man, that's like my sister. We grew up together. And I said, buddy, we about to be family then. Like, let's go ahead, get to know each other. And we hung out that night. And, you know, we went to this restaurant after with a big group. And I went and sat by myself and acted like I didn't know anybody. And then here she comes. She's talking to me, sitting with me. You know, Pastor West knew how to play the game just a little bit back in the day. I'm just hyping myself up at this point. Everybody knows I'm married up. This is a comment that everybody in this church knows. She asked me, she said, hey, would you like to come lead worship at the youth group I'm running and fix our tech stuff? It needs a little bit of help. And I said, sure, but we have to ride together. See what I'm saying, Darren? I learned a little bit. We go and we sing and it was awesome and come back, driving her back home, and we look at each other and something weird happened. We looked each other in the eyes and said that we loved each other and we're supposed to get married. First time we got together. I want to encourage you, do not take that as a literal thing that you need to go do if you are single. Do not walk up to some random person, hey, let's go to a Krispy Kreme, find somebody with donuts, it works. I love you. But we both had this assurance from the Lord, like we're supposed to get married. Then she drops this bombshell on me, hey, 4 months from now, I'm leaving for Peru for almost 2 years. Okay. All right. Our relationship then looks a little bit different than it did now. Those first 4 months, it was fun. It was exciting. And everything seemed easy. And as she went for almost 2 years, we Skyped about once a month as she went into the jungle to minister to the kids. And she's talking about some other crazy animal that she dealt with or some nasty worm that she ate or something and telling me all these stories. Y'all, I'm telling you, this woman can survive. If we ever get on a TV show of Survivor, I'm just going to hang out with her. She's awesome. And she just called me and she came back and we got engaged and we got married. And what I've learned is our relationship then was exciting, but I don't care to go back then because I love where we are now. It may be a little bit more difficult. It may have a little bit more hurdles and things that you have to navigate, but good things don't come easy. And I've learned that healthy relationships aren't easy either. But the way that I show her love now, I have learned a greater level of what that looks like because of time spent. And the more time that we spend with God, the greater level that we come to an understanding of what His love looks like for us and what it's called to look like for other people. Love changes in seasons, but love is always necessary. We learn that worldly love and a godly love is different. Two things about a worldly love. The first one is that a worldly love is conditional. Matthew 5, 43 through 48, you have heard the law that says, love your neighbor and hate your enemies, but I say, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. In that way, you will be acting as true children of your Father in heaven. He gives His sunlight to both the evil and the good. He sends rain on the just and the unjust alike. If you love only those who love you, what reward is there for that? Even corrupt tax collectors do that much. Or if you are kind only to your friends, how are you different from anyone else? Even pagans do that, but you are to be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. A worldly love is conditional. What the world wants to teach us is if they don't agree with you, then you need to cancel them. If they don't make you feel better about yourself, well, then they're not good friends. What I've learned about good friends is they're typically the first ones to step up and pull you aside and talk to you when you're doing something wrong. If you just want people to hype you up, that's not a true friend. But if you want friends, you want somebody who you need to go to war with, spiritual war with in your life, it needs to be somebody who's going to lock arms with you, and we're called to be those people. The world tells us that if they become your enemy, well, then just ignore them and write them off. If they don't say nice things to you, if they're gossiping about you at work, well, then you just need to step up and you just need to come after them. It has infected our teenagers. I substitute taught a PE class one time with these middle school kids. I don't know who trusted me to do that. But these two boys were sitting here talking to each other. They dapped each other up, said, what's up, man? This little kid said, hey, buddy, how are you? And he accidentally steps on his shoes. They squared up in less than 3 seconds. I was like, what are y'all doing? You know you're not gonna fit in those in 6 months from now. The world has taught our kids that if somebody doesn't agree with you and make you feel better about yourself, well, then they're wrong. And then if we do that, We can never be wrong. And we don't need the truth because our truth is the only truth that matters. The world's love is conditional. But God's love is unconditional. God says to love your enemies. The world says hate your enemies. God says love them. The world says slander those people who talk bad about you. But God says love them. God says cherish them. He says encourage them. He says that person that's been messing with you at work or makes your life so difficult, you know what? You need to bring them lunch one day. Just bring them a good Bowberry biscuit. That's the nicest southern gesture anybody could do. You need to come in and you need to say, hey, you look great today. The love that's taught by the world is one that says, you know what, I'm only going to spend time around people who make me feel better about myself, but what a godly love looks like is going around people who think differently than you and loving them through it. This is what Jesus did. Jesus spent all his time with tax collectors, Christian murderers, with prostitutes, with adulterers. Jesus were with these people all the time because he didn't judge them for what they'd done, but he knew that they had a greater future. And his love can change anybody. How many people have been changed by the love of God today? Amen. The world says, I will love you as long as you affirm me. But what a godly love says, I will only find love in his affirmation. A worldly love is conditional. A worldly love is also shallow. Matthew chapter 13, 20 through 21. The seed on the rocky soil represents those who hear the message and immediately receive it with joy. But since they don't have deep roots, they don't last long. They will fall away as soon as they have problems or are persecuted for believing God's word. If you want to know if somebody has a shallow love, well, watch how they react when times get difficult. A worldly love is shallow. A worldly love will lead us down dark halls that we think will benefit us, but will ultimately end up in a room that's empty and lifeless. Addiction seems so exciting in the moment. Our flesh and fulfilling the needs of our flesh feels so exciting in the moment. But then every single time you end back up in the same place of disappointment and heartbreak and emptiness. It's because you were never meant to find what true love is through the lens of this world. A relationship can't fix it. A work environment can't fix it. Friends can't fix it. You were born with a void in your soul and it can only be filled with a relationship with Jesus. A worldly love is shallow. I don't want shallow friends. I don't want people that when I'm going through something difficult, as long as it's convenient, they'll show up to my house and help me. I want to surround myself with people who love the Lord so much that no matter what happens, we're locked arms. We're there. Not only do you need those types of people in your life, but we must be those people who don't love in a conditional love and don't have a shallow type of love. Because a lot of us want a deep love and a deepened relationship with Jesus, but we have a shallow level of preparation. We have a shallow level of expectation. I don't want to live in a life that's just in the shallow end. I want to experience more of what God has for me. One day, you're gonna have to take off the floaties to learn how to swim. I remember going through this with Henley and she was so terrified and it's amazing how scary 5 feet of water is when you're a little kid, even when there's people surrounding you. Some of you are still afraid of water because your parents taught you how to swim by picking you up and throwing you in the pool. Everybody, I've had people tell me that story. I really hope that's not true. I also really hope you learn how to swim in that moment. Oh, they'll figure it out. Yeah, well, people don't float, so. But at some point, you're going to have to take off the floaties. You know, we love the comfort of the shallow end where you can touch the floor because this is where I have control. This is where I can dictate my posture. This is where I can either stand here. You see kids. The kids, the little kids, most of the time when they go to the pool, where do they hang out at? They hang out on the steps. Because it's a place that they can find their feet and they can find control and they can find comfort and they know what to expect and know how, no matter how crazy the water gets to the people around them, they can always keep their feet firmly planted on the ground. But if we want to have a deepened relationship with the Lord, well, one, it's going to take you not having control. Two, it's going to be you taking off the aids and the vices that are keeping you from experience deeper with Jesus. You can't say, God, take me deeper and still hold on to the same addiction. Hold on to the same issues. Hold on to the same habits because those things will keep you afloat, that will keep you from experiencing the fullness of what God wants to do in your life. If you want to experience a deeper relationship, a deeper experience with your Heavenly Father, you must take off everything and say, God, here I am. Lord, take me wherever the waves permit. Wherever your spirit leads, that's where I want to go. I want to be so deep in my relationship with the Lord that I have no control. All I have is obedience. I want to live a deepened relationship with the Lord because I've learned that that's what a true relationship with God looks like. A worldly love is conditional and it's shallow. A godly love is exactly the opposite. It's unconditional and it's never ending. Romans 5:8, but God showed his great love. You want to learn what love is? You want to highlight something in the month of February? This is the verse you need to read every morning. For God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners, while we were disqualifying ourselves, while we were still broken, while we still are broken, while we'll still be broken tomorrow. How many people fail every day? Christ loved you so much that he knew you would spend your whole life sinning. And he still sent his son so that you could find a relationship with him, so that you could find hope, so that you could find peace, so that you could find love. I've learned that there's so much more to the never-ending love of God than we'll ever understand. Jeremiah 33 says this, ask me and I will tell you remarkable secrets you do not know about things to come. Do you know there's things that we don't know? Somebody needs to remind a friend of that today. You know there's things you don't know? Don't do that. That's not the love of Jesus. I'm sorry. Lord, forgive me. There's things we don't know. There's things we'll never fully comprehend. But I'm greater that the love of Jesus is beyond my comprehension. I'm grateful that love is for me. Ephesians 3:16 through 20 says this as the band comes and helps me close. I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your heart as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ. Though it is too great to understand fully, then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now all glory to God who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we could ask or think. May you experience the love of Christ. The love of Jesus is one of those things that's great to know about, but everything changes when you experience it. See, people can give you all the marriage tips that you want before you're married, but you don't really know what you're thinking about until you're there. It can teach you about different things of life, of being a parent, of the workplace environment, of growing up and being an adult, whatever it may be, but sometimes you have to truly experience it to have a good perspective. This is one of those things. That when we experience the love of God, everything changes. What I'm so grateful for is that no matter where you are or how far you feel from God, he wants you to experience that great love today. Sometimes we ask for a never-ending outpouring of the love of God and we have a shallow level of preparation. Sometimes we want a big love for God, but we don't reciprocate the effort. I'm gonna ask you this, especially the married people in the house. Never let your expectations outwork your effort. We can come into a relationship and say, well, I'll love you if. And that's the moment we're operating in a worldly love and a love that's not of God. It's not conditional. Never let your expectations of what you're ready to receive be greater than the effort that you give. I want to challenge you to do something today, something that could change your relationship, your life. No matter where you are, no matter your capacity of relationship in an instant, is to outserve the person next to you. Full of humility. Oftentimes we have conditions to the love that we speak about, but God's called us not only to experience his deep love, but to emulate that love. There's three things I want you to write down. Everybody pull out your phone, pull out a piece of paper. I don't care if you use the U-card, whatever you need. How to go from a shallow love to a deep love. This could change your relationship today. The first thing, go from knowing to doing. The world has not changed by somebody who had great dreams and aspirations. The world changed by somebody who had great dreams and aspirations and then put in the work. It's not just enough to know, we must also do. The Bible says, do the things that I have commanded you. It says to walk in obedience. This is why in the Great Commission, he says, make disciples of all nations and teach them to obey the things I have commanded you to do, because it's not enough just to share the message. You must show them that love. You must show them what obedience looks like. The first step to go from a shallow love to a deep love, even just in your relationship with Jesus, is go from knowing to doing. God's called you to give. God's called you to serve. He's called you to be a part of a community. He's called you to spend time with him. It's not enough just to aspire it. We must walk in that obedience. Your life will be made up by all the little things that you do consistently. What are the things that you do? Go from knowing to doing. The second thing is step in when there's a gap. See, a lot of us will walk through life and we'll see moments to help somebody and we'll look at them as inconveniences instead of opportunities. That's a mental switch. Somebody's got a blown tire. Well, I got to get to work. It's an inconvenience. Somebody's waiting on me. I got to get home. You're in the store. I know when they call themselves a believer because they all walk like this. We're trying to get from thing to thing. We don't want to be bothered. This is my me time through the grocery store. I was in Publix the other day, and me and this guy, we got out of our vehicles at the same time. He's a taller guy, and we were both walking through Publix into the soup section. How many people like them a good Publix soup? Come on, that turkey, sausage, kale, sweet potato thing, that's of the Lord. That is of the Lord, anointed. We're walking together, and it's kind of odd because he's kind of right behind me, and we're just walking to the soup section, and we get up, and we pull up soups, and I'm like, hey, man, what you getting? We ended up getting the same soup, and we walked to the same cash register. As we were about to check out, I was like, hey, man, throw your soup on there. He's like, are you sure? I was like, yeah, dude, come on, I got you. We got the same mentality right now. Let me pay for it. And he just begins to break down. He's like, you don't know how much that means. Starts to tear up, and I'm like, dude, it's just a $4 soup. Like, that's what I needed today, is what he said. Just a moment of somebody being seen can change their life. You don't know how many people, because you know how you need to be seen, how many people in this world are never seen. They don't have people to go home to or a hope to cling to like you have your relationship with the Lord. Oftentimes, the things that we call inconveniences are really God presenting opportunities for you to walk in your purpose. That's why I'm grateful that we have the greatest front door holders in the history of the church. Paul would have written an entire chapter about David Seaford and Wally Wallace. So many times I get text messages and phone calls of like, you don't know how much that meant to me. That's the first time I've gotten hugged in a long time. See, we live in this world of busyness and where we have love at a touch of our fingers or we forget it. Maybe it's you in this room. There's a lot of people who don't know what that looks like. That's why we serve. That's why we have adults in the kids ministry. It's not so they tear down the walls. They don't destroy everything, although that is nice that they don't do that. But it's so that they can experience that Christ-like love that will call them back to their divine design. Go from knowing to doing. The second thing is step in when there's a gap. God's going to present an opportunity, not an inconvenience to you this week. And I'm challenging you to take the time and help somebody. It could change their eternity. The last thing is love without expectation of return. Go from knowing to doing. Step in when there's a gap. And learn to love without an expectation of return. It's a lot easier for us to sit in front of our spouse or in front of a friend and say, this is all the things that I need to feel love. It's a lot harder for us to sit down and say, these are the things that I'm going to do. But we are called to live a life serving. The Son of God came not to be served, but to serve. The one who deserved it most, to have everything handed to him, walk through life serving other people, loving other people without an expectation of a return. As he's hanging on the cross, being spat on, being cussed at, his clothes ripped, they're gambling for his belongings, he looks at God and says, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. That's the kind of love that we're called to walk in. That's the kind of love that we're called to show others. Not one that's shallow, but one that's deep. How do you love others with a deep love? Will you wade yourself in the deep waters of the Lord? Would you stand with me? You learn more how to love people well the time you spend with somebody. You learn more about the love of God and how to love others with a godly love. We're called to go from knowing to doing. Stepping in the gap. Help others. Use our gifts to serve. And love without an expectation of return. For a worldly love is conditional and it's shallow. A lot of people will dive headfirst into the love of this world and hope for a return, and they come back with a concussion. Why is there a big red circle with a slash in it that says no diving in the 2-foot water? Because some goober decided it was a good idea to try to dive in that water. Worldly love will never bring back a full heart. But a godly love is never ending. And it's just for you. If you're here today, I want everybody to close their eyes right where you are. And you say, you know what? I need to experience that love. I need to step back into that divine design. I've been feeling lonely. I'm the one who's hurting. I need to experience the love of Jesus. I need to experience that depth that we're talking about. If that's you, what I'm going to ask you to do is, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. The Bible says, boldly proclaim that Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that he died on the cross for you and ye shall be saved. He died on the cross and rose again. And what we're doing is, when you raise your hand, it's a symbol of, I want to step back into my purpose. I want to step back into that love. I want to find that peace and that joy that only comes from the Father. I want to find that understanding that when eternity is sealed, that I will be on the good side that God has been preparing for me. If that's you, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. I need that love. 1, 2, 3. Go ahead right now. If you're here, I need to experience that love. I need to realign my relationship with the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, can we celebrate with the two that raised their hand today and chose Jesus? Amen. Amen. Two guys with me, I want you to look at me real quick. I've got one thing that I want you to do directly after this service. I'm going to have some people who are going to be at this corner right here. I want you to come. The moment I pray, don't leave. I'll hunt you down. I'll find you, just like that guy did at Publix. I will be right behind you. Come up here. We've got some people who want to pray with you and also give you some free things, because finding that love and stepping into that relationship isn't just a decision, it's a journey. Also, if you're here and you just need prayer for something this morning, our prayer team's also going to be available at this altar for a moment after service. There's something that you walk through that you need people with. Last reminder, and we'll get you out of here. Well, there's two reminders. Last reminder of one of the two. These boards are up here from us writing names down of people who are lost that we're going to invite to Easter. Your goal, if you haven't already done this, is to write a name down. We got sticky notes, pens, and sticky things up here. Write the name down and you're going to intercede. You're going to pray for them. You're going to invest time into them, and then you're going to invite them to Easter Sunday. That's what these boards are. If you haven't already done that, would love for you to step into that. We're believing for God to bring a harvest of salvations. Vision team luncheon. We've got our baby dedication, and also our women's Bible study will be here this week, Wednesday, 6 p.m. God, I bless this incredible congregation, this family, that you would be with them, that you would create opportunities for us to experience your love in a mighty way and also to operate in it. God, we wouldn't see it as an inconvenience, that we would get out of the shallow waters, we would take off the floaties, and we would dive deep into the love that is found in you. thank you for who you are and the life that you've called us and given us to live. In the mighty name of Jesus, everybody say.